Hello, friends. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Let us approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. That's Hebrews 4:16. Welcome. Glad you're here. We're here to receive mercy and find grace. The good news is that when we come together, even online like this, asking for grace and mercy from God, He's faithful to lavish His mercy and His grace on us. Hey, I've been looking forward to this hour or so together as we worship and pray and hear from God's Word. I'm glad you're here today. So thanks. Thanks for taking this time with us today. Hey, as always, you know, like, share, subscribe, interact with us on the comments. We want to hear from you. We want to know you're there. And when you say hi or leave your questions or comments, when you subscribe or share or like, that helps us spread the word. So thanks for doing that. Listen, it's not just a TV show, not just a online thing on the web. This is a time to worship together. It's a time for us to engage and sing and to pray. So participate today. Would you lean in? Let's see what God has for us today. Well, we're going to turn our attention to a song, worshiping together, setting our focus upward on God. This song is a song of testimony, a song that reminds us that God has a way of lifting us, of turning our lives around when we turn to Him. It's a glorious day.
Breathing the night alive.
know, therefore, that God, that the Lord, your God, is God. He's the faithful God, keeping his covenant of love to 1,000 generations of those who love him and keep his commandments. That's Deuteronomy 7:9, but really, the entire Bible is a testament of God's faithfulness. We wander, we lose track, we waver, but not God. He's faithful, always faithful, faithful to the end.
We're heaven-spun creations, his pride and adoration, treasures woven by his love. His careful hands, they hold us safe within his promise of calling and of destiny. We're heaven-spun. Calling.
that you're not by my side, there won't be a day that you let us fall. In all of our lives, your love will be true. With all of our lives, we will worship you. There won't be a day that you aren't by our side.
I look back over my life and see that God is faithful, never absent, always leading, always working in and through my life. Thank you, God, that you're faithful. Friends, we have a faithful God, faithful to the end. Well, thanks again, friend, for being with us. And remember to check in with us online here. That helps us, and we want to know you're there. So say hi, like, subscribe, comment, share, all of that. Thanks for doing that. The best way to keep track of what's going on at North Shore is on the web, cpnorthshore.com. You can pull down that resources menu from the top, and North Shore News contains the most up-to-date resources for you there. If you look there, you'll see that, well, there's an announcement that we'll be wrapping things up at North Shore under this kind of current configuration and pastoral leadership. We're going to wrap it up on 6/27. We just have a few more Sundays, both in person in Kenmore and online like this. In July, well, I'm off. So if you can be with us at 10:30 in Kenmore on that day, on the 27th, that last Sunday of June, I think it'll be great. I hope you'll be with us as we'll have a special time together. And friends, thanks for your giving. Thank you for your faithful support of our work together in Kenmore and on this broadcast and throughout our region and around the world with our world missionaries. Thank you for your faithful support. You can give online. There's a button there on the website. You can give with the Push Pay app like Lori and I do right on our phones. Super convenient. Drop it off, send it by. Thank you for your faithfulness in giving. Well, I do like to pray along these lines. Would you join me for a moment? Father, thank you. Thank you for your faithfulness to us as our provider. Thank you, God, that you are our provider, and we give you thanks for your provision. And we thank you that you invite us into your work like this, worshiping with our giving, putting parts of our lives into your work in these ways. Thank you that you empower faithful hands to put it to good work, that the Holy Spirit leads and directs and empowers it to accomplish eternal things. What an enterprise. What a great thing to be part of. We thank you for this opportunity to give and this opportunity to thank you again for your provision. And we thank you for all of it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, with just a few weeks left in this pulpit at North Shore, I thought we'd go ahead and jump back into our series from the New Testament book of Luke, focused on the words of Jesus. It's a series that we've called Church in the Red, since a lot of the Bibles that we have print the words of Jesus in red, so Church in the Red. Now, we'll pick up where we left off last time, putting us right in the midst of Luke chapter 13, if you're following along in a Bible. You saw that I titled the message, Who's In? Who's In? You know, it seems to me that, well, we spend a lot of time thinking about who's in and consequently, who's out. You know, regardless of the group or team or various classifications and such, You know, we might think in terms of nationalities or backgrounds, those who've qualified for some elite status or not, perhaps political affiliations and such. Yeah, who's in? I hear people express concern from time to time that technology has separated us, that our devices and various digital platforms have, you know, done damage to our ability to connect with one another. And I suppose that's true on some level. But, well, the inverse seems true too. That our digital doodads, especially our social media networks, have allowed us to segregate into focused niches. Whether it's in the groups and such that we opt into online, or the algorithms designed to focus our connections and attention toward like-minded folks, our technology has allowed us to group up into more and more narrow cliques. Time and space no longer limit us in determining who's in. While we're techno-charged in our day and age, people have formed ourselves into groups from the beginning, perhaps perfected by religious people like us. We religious folks seem to occupy a lot of our time and effort determining just who's in and who's out. It's been going on for millennia, including two millennia ago, the specific time and place of today's text. So picking up at Luke 13:22, we read, "Then Jesus went through the towns and villages, teaching as he made his way to Jerusalem." Well, you know, since it's been, well, a while since we've been in this series, this Church in the Red series from Luke, this is a good reminder, because Jesus, along with his followers, is on a mission. He's on the way to Jerusalem. Now, he's taking his time with a really slow pace, teaching and, well, miraculously meeting needs along the way. Jesus is on a trek to accomplish his mission in the holy city, in Jerusalem. So, along the way, someone asked him, "Lord, are only a few people going to be saved?" Well, there's that vital question. Who's in? Are only a few people going to be saved? You know, it isn't only a matter of numbers, right? Few or many, or even all, for that matter. The question implies the how and who of it all. Not only how many will be saved, but who are they and how will they be saved? And perhaps, am I in the group? Well, Jesus said to them, "Make every effort to enter through the narrow door." Other translations say, strive to enter through the narrow door. Strive. How does that strike you? You know, if you listen to me talk about this faith much, you'll recall that I'm confident in the grace of Jesus. I want us all to be confident in the grace of God. Our striving isn't the answer, it's our believing. Perhaps striving, making every effort, well, maybe, perhaps that doesn't align well with grace. Or, I don't know, perhaps striving sounds about right to you, that the religious life is a strict life, a rigorous life, earning a way through a discriminating door, a narrow door that only allows a select few through. So we should read on to understand precisely what Jesus means by striving to get in through a narrow door. Make every effort to enter through the narrow door, because many, I tell you, Jesus said, will try to enter and will not be able to. Once the owner of the house gets up and closes the door, you will stand outside knocking and pleading, "Sir, open the door for us." But he will answer, "I don't know you or where you come from." Well, first thing, this reveals something about that striving. There is a time element. Apparently, if we read this text in the original language, a language that was more specific with tenses than our English, the tense is important there. We would see that Jesus said, "Listen, make every effort now, now to enter through the narrow door." It isn't merely identifying the door, seeing that it is narrow, and striving toward it. It's a matter of doing it now, because there will be a moment when that door closes. We have decisions to make in this life that bear eternal consequences. And it's not merely a matter of believing in this life, it is a matter of believing now, because there's no guarantee of tomorrow. There's not even a guarantee of our next breath. Today, right now, is a day to believe. So, the door is closed and we can't get in, as Jesus paints the picture. And why can't we get through that narrow door? Well, it's not because of a secret password or special knowledge. It's not because of having attained a certain status, credentials, or wealth. It's not because of who we're related to, what tribe or nationality or race or other identity that we bear. I mean, these are all the sorts of things we might attach to religion these days. And we're certainly attached to religion in that day in which Jesus responded to that question. But none of these were part of the answer. But rather, the one who controlled access, the one who could open the door said, "I don't know you." You don't know me. You don't know us. How can that possibly be? Well, that objection is not written in the text, but it is implied when Jesus went on to say, "Listen, we ate and drank with you, and you taught in our streets." In our day, we might say, "Hey, we celebrated your big days. Christmas and Easter, had big meals. We knew about you. We were around. We knew some of the data points about you." But do we know Jesus? And more importantly, does God know us? So the door is narrow and the door is shut, slam shut. It says there'll be weeping there and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourselves thrown out. People will come from the east and the west and the north and the south and will take their places at the feast in the kingdom of God. There's a narrow door, a shut door, and now a picture of doors in every direction, north, south, east, and west. Well, which is it? It seems like Jesus was trying to stir people up. Well, there is no doubt that the ears hearing it from the lips of Jesus were stirred up. They were descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And that lineage had everything to do with their salvation, their ability to pass through the door and take their place at the feast. It was a matter of inheritance. How could it be that they are in Jacob, Isaac, Abraham, but those were out? Before we keep moving on, notice that Jesus indicates that he indicates what's on the other side of the narrow door. It's the kingdom of God, and more specifically, the feast in the kingdom of God. And it's not just any feast, but the feast. This idea of a banquet or feast, well, that's going to be further developed in the coming passages. When Jesus referred to the feast that day, it would have likely brought to mind powerful images of what God promised through the prophets. Yeah. Isaiah described it like this: "On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats." Good meats? I'm listening. "The best of meats and the finest of wines." There it is, wine again. I guess there'll be wine in the kingdom of God for eternity. I guess there's no disease in heaven, so no disease in eternity, no disease, so no alcoholism, so wine. It says, "On this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death." Yeah, that's the shroud, the sheet. "He will swallow up death forever. The sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove his people's disgrace from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. In that day they will say, 'Surely this is our God. We trusted in him and he saved us. This is the Lord. We trusted in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation.'" This great feast eternally celebrates salvation. It's a wedding banquet, eternally uniting Christ with his bride, the church, the body of believers. The way Jesus describes it, some who expects to be there won't, and some of the least will be there, even among the first. He said, "Indeed, there are those who are last who will be first, and first who will be last." First and last. You know, first and last carries multiple meanings. I mean, it could be a matter of sequence, right? And it could be a matter of status. And I think we can embrace both meanings. From the perspective of sequence, you know, those hearing Jesus believed that, the ancients would be first in any eternal kingdom, including Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and those who followed in their ways, their descendants, well, they would be right behind. But Jesus was turning the order of things upside down, proclaiming that what was ancient, what was old, what was first, was no longer first. The new, better way had come. The door changed. The rules changed. The hierarchies changed. We can see how the door changed in the next passage. It says, at that time, some Pharisees came to Jesus and said to him, "Leave this place and go somewhere else. Herod wants to kill you." He replied, "Go tell that fox, I will keep on driving out demons and healing people today and tomorrow, and on the third day, I will reach my goal. In any case, I must press on today and tomorrow and the next day, for surely no prophet can die outside Jerusalem." It was a commentary on the religious structure. Those that warned Jesus weren't concerned that the occupiers would kill Jesus. They weren't worried about Rome or Caesar or Pilate, but rather Herod. Herod, the quasi-religious, quasi-governmental, quasi-cultural tetrarch, the titular head of the Jews. Yeah, it wasn't news to Jesus that Jerusalem was dangerous for him. I mean, apart from his spiritual insight, history taught that, well, Jerusalem turned on her prophets. And Jesus went on to say, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. You see, Jews saw Jerusalem as the door to eternity, the earthly point of connection with God. The way to God's favor was through Jerusalem, the center of religion, the place of the temple, the sacrifices, and the most holy place. But Jerusalem was not the door. Jerusalem is superseded by the eternal King, Jesus, the Lord. There are those who are last who will be first, and first who will be last. The door changed. And the rules changed. We see that moving forward with chapter 14. It says, one Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat in the house of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched. There in front of him was a man suffering from abnormal swelling of his body. And Jesus asked the Pharisees and experts in the law, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not? But they remained silent. So, taking hold of the man, Jesus healed him and sent him on his way. You know, we can speculate about that scene. You know, it would have been customary to enjoy a Sabbath meal after, you know, the morning teaching in the synagogue. And Jesus routinely taught in synagogues on the Sabbath. This scene can simply be a matter of the synagogue leaders hosting the preacher for a meal after church. Seems reasonable. Doesn't it? Anyone have plans for lunch today? What was unexpected here was the presence of this diseased one. He was out of place. Of all times for this unclean one to show up, on a Sabbath, in the midst of these religious dignitaries, this was the worst occasion. It was offensive. But for Jesus, the offense was an opportunity. Offenses are often opportunities if we dare to see them so. Jesus often healed on the Sabbath, much to the consternation of the religious leaders who were certain such work on the Sabbath was sacrilegious. For Jesus, it was first things first. In healing this one, who was the very least in the crowd, took priority over dining with the best. The rules changed. Then Jesus asked them, if one of you has a child or an ox that falls into a well on the Sabbath day, will you not immediately pull it out? And they had nothing to say. Yeah, the rules had changed, but standing behind the rules all along was the grace of God. The Sabbath was made for people to worship, not for anyone to suffer, not even the livestock. Grace was the foundation of the Sabbath laws, and grace ran through the Sabbath laws that made room for emergencies. Grace, indeed, undergirded all the law, whether people could see it or not. The door changed and the rules changed and the hierarchies changed. When Jesus noticed how the guests picked the places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, give this person your seat. Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. Seating arrangements. I suppose we think about seating arrangements from time to time at special events, you know, such as wedding receptions. Has anyone labored over seating charts? But most of us are not as preoccupied with seating assignments as they would have been in that culture. Determining who was invited, who accepted invitations, and how seating was arranged all had a great deal to do with status. In verse 1 of chapter 14 there, we read that Jesus was being carefully watched. Here we see that Jesus was carefully watching them, and soon they would be carefully considering themselves. It's often so with Jesus. We start by critically inspecting Jesus, but it often doesn't take long before we are critically inspecting ourselves. Jesus went on saying, but when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, friend, move up to a better place. Then you'll be honored in the presence of all the other guests. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Clearly, striving to enter through the narrow door is not a matter of exalting ourselves, but rather a matter of humility. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. The hierarchy's changed. Then Jesus said to his host, when you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor. Invite the crippled. Invite the lame, the blind, and you'll be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. That culture put a lot of thought into the way meals were shared, the ceremony of it all. I mean, mealtime is important. It's exclusive. It's an intimate and time reserved for the closest relationships. You see, guest lists were routinely prepared with an inward focus. When inviting others, the host would generally ask this simple question: what's in it for me? How will I be honored by these people? How might my status increase? How will I be repaid? But Jesus, turning upside down the conventions of status and hierarchies, Jesus calls us to an outward focus, welcoming in those who cannot repay. I mean, that's a pattern modeled by Jesus, right? We, of course, are among the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. We cannot repay the gifts Jesus lavishes on us. We have no banquet that could ever compare to what he provides. All we can do is follow his example with all our hearts and souls, all our minds and strength. The hierarchy's changed. There are those who are last who will be first, and first who will be last. Well, with all of that talk of the resurrection of the righteous and heavenly banquets, someone couldn't help themselves and blurted out, blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God. And Jesus replied, well, a certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, come, for everything is now ready. I mean, this is how Jesus often taught, right? With a parable, with a story that powerfully conveyed an eternal truth. Now, I suppose there could have been such a certain man sending out invitations, but in this story, who do you suppose is the certain man preparing a great banquet and inviting many? Well, of course, Jesus. Jesus prepares the great banquet and invites multiplied many. But, verse 18 says, they all alike began to make excuses. The first said, I have just bought a field and I must go see it. Please excuse me. And another said, well, I have just bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm on my way to try them out. please excuse me. Still another said, hey, I just got married, so I can't come. Excuses, excuses, excuses. We make up our excuses to not accept the call of Jesus, to not accept his invitations. These excuses here, perhaps coincidentally, mirror the valid excuses that might cancel or at least delay military service, obligations for military service in that day. Apparently, they didn't think men should have to go off to and die in battle before enjoying their stuff and their wives and their families. Excuses. But when it comes to excuses, it seems that the rich are often the most successful at raising such objections and wiggling out of difficult consequences. I mean, if you had land and livestock in that day, you were rich. These days, well, if you have money and lawyers, you can often escape harsh consequences with your complex excuses. So, once processing the excuses in the parable that Jesus was telling, the servant came back and reported this to his master. And then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant, go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. Well, sir, the servant said, what you ordered has been done, but there's still room. Well, then the master told his servant, go out to the roads and country lanes. Go out there and compel them to come in so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those who were invited will get a taste of my banquet. The point here goes right back to where we started. Strive now because preparations are underway. Strive now because the invitation is made. We don't want to be among those in round one, those who received the invitation and discarded it, making excuses, considering something more urgent or more important than accepting the master's call. And we can see ourselves in round two, I hope, you know, the poor and the crippled, the blind and the lame who are brought in. But what of round three, those who were compelled to come in? Those in round two had nothing to lose. Those in round one thought they had too much to lose. But these who needed to be compelled were perhaps, I don't know, somewhere in the middle. Perhaps they were cautious about accepting the invitation because of their doubts. Yeah, in that culture, there were times when one would not dare accept an invitation. They didn't think they could fit in. They might not be able to bear the obligation to repay. The invitation wasn't for them. Couldn't be for them. Perhaps it was too good to be true. But the welcome is true. The invitation is there. So it takes some convincing. They must be compelled. You know, looking back to when I came to faith, I needed to be compelled. And I'm so glad I was. Maybe you're being compelled too. Maybe those around us need to be compelled. All this brings us back to what Jesus first said. Make every effort to enter through the narrow door. It is a narrow door. But it might not be narrow in the way that we think. An exclusive passage only meant for a scarce few. It is a narrow door in that it is the one way. What is that door? The better question is, who is that door? The door isn't a thing or a place. The door is a person. Jesus is the door. Jesus is the way. Jesus says it plainly. He says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. We enter through the narrow door. Jesus is the narrow door. The door is narrow not because it's secret. The door's narrow in so much that it is one at a time. Jesus meets us and saves us one at a time. It's not a matter of what group we're in, not a matter of ancestry or membership, not a matter of status or privilege or politics or race or anything else. No, it's one at a time, one by one, as we believe. Jesus again said it plainly. He said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." Who's in? Well, friend, you are welcomed in. Today is a day to believe. Right now is a moment of salvation, to believe in Jesus and have eternal life. Well, maybe you think it's not for you. Maybe you think your position or background, or status or doubts are keeping you out. I'm compelling you today. Jesus is compelling you today. The Holy Spirit is compelling you today. Believe. It can start with a simple prayer. Jesus, I believe. Just those three words. Jesus, I believe. You can pray it with me out loud right now. Jesus, I believe. I know God hears that prayer and answers it. And you can start that journey today. You can take that first step through the door with that prayer. Jesus, I believe. And for us who do believe, let's continue to make every effort to enter through the narrow door. You know, it's easy for us to bring our own righteousness, our accomplishments and such. You know, we must continually strip ourselves of all that and enter through the narrow door, through Jesus. And furthermore, let's be sure to welcome others, all others, through that door. Let's be sure to live the gospel, and share the gospel so that others may enter along with us. Let's pray together to that end. Father, thank you for the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus, I believe. Forgive us our sin, and thank you for the forgiveness that we have through Jesus. Holy Spirit of God, empower us to live as people of the way. And give us gifts of courage and faith and opportunity to welcome others too. And we pray in that great name of Jesus, the door, the way, the truth, and the life. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, friend, thanks again for being with us today. I'm sure glad that you were here. If there's any way that we can serve you, please don't hesitate to let us know. Looking forward to the weeks ahead. And I usually send you off with a blessing from Scripture. We're going to sing a blessing. And this blessing is from Scripture as well. God bless you, friends. Grace be with you all. And be blessed.
His face shine upon you. Children, may his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 he is for you.
Gracious. to you. The Lord turns.